Hey guys, I'm Larson the Wolf, and I just finished The Vanishing of Ethan Carter. Alongside me for this video today will be Simplefox, or Guy. He's a close friend of mine, and he just finished it as well. This is our first conversation about the game. So enjoy!
1 through 10, what number would you give it?
I don't like giving numbers to games.
I don't either, but just a TLDR on it.
6 or a 7.
I would give it a 7.5, a solid 7.5, bordering on 8. Let's start out with what's good.
Okay, for the what's good, very much so the graphics.
Yeah.
And
the scenery in general.
The scenery in general never had me astounded. Unfortunately, I played Dear Esther right before I played it, and I didn't play all of Dear Esther, but I played up until the cave scene in Dear Esther, which is a magnificent, like, anybody who's played Dear Esther knows that cave is just amazing, and there was no jaw-dropping moment in that game, but I always enjoyed the scenery for the most part.
Okay, I think in the very beginning, like, when you're going across the, very first bridge and you could see across the lake and there's all the forest on both sides.
Yeah.
That was a really cool moment. I like that. I thought that looked really cool. And I think there were moments that were like very clearly you're supposed to sit and soak in what they set up, the scenery they set up. Like you got to the alien part, right? Where they got shut up into space.
I had to go back to that.
Yeah.
Because I never found it the first time.
See, I got that the first time, and I was confused, because that was the first encounter I ever got.
Mm-hmm.
Confused the shit out of me. I thought this was part of the game. I was like, oh, this took a turn. I thought I was going to go to a weird supernatural thing.
Yeah.
No, but yeah, you're up in space, and you're looking around. It gives you almost too long, it felt like, at least to
me.
It's just, you're just staring out into space. But there were definitely moments I thought stood out, but I think you're right. I think Dear Esther's pictures... The scenery in that was much...
I even played the Landmark Edition, which was the recent update to it.
Well, we're playing the Redux Edition of Ethan Carter, though.
Yeah, well, so we're playing the Redux in both versions, and I'll still say Ethan Carter looked better, but there was no astounding pieces to me. Like, I went through and I noticed in Dear Esther, if you still look at the plants, they're nothing more than two 2D images set as a cross.
Mm-hmm.
So when I paid close attention, that was it. They had updated the features a good bit, and they looked a heck of a lot better, but they were still 2D images. I never found any 2D images, though, in The Vanishing of Ethan Carter, and I looked for them. So that was well done.
Okay. I think it's a bit unfair here.
Yeah.
First of all, that we're comparing it to Dear Esther.
Because
Ethan Carter, in my opinion, is far more of a game, I'm using quotations here.
Quotations, yeah.
Than Dear Esther ever is. Mm-hmm. But the argument, whenever someone is critiquing Dear Esther or critiquing Ethan Carter, someone comparing the two is inevitable.
They're two intrinsically different things.
But... Typically, if you hate Dear Esther, you don't like the fact you don't have a run mechanic, and
that's
you don't,
painful in that game.
And you don't, and the narrative is fucking hard to understand, purposely thick.
Mm-hmm.
This is not so in Ethan Carter. I understood everything that was going on for the most part.
For the most part, yeah.
It wasn't thick, but it was still flowery at times. Like, the inner monologue your character has were still pretty poetic, but it wasn't to the point where it was, really, you had to play it over and over again and digest it like you do in Dear Esther.
Or Dear Esther. Well, that's the story aspects of Dear Esther is a thick, and if you don't have a good knowledge of the Bible, you will not get the story of Dear Esther. However, in Ethan Carter, no, you don't need any backing of any sort of cultural writing or anything. You know the story. It's pretty straightforward and simple.
Right.
When you get down to the end of it.
The other thing is, in Dear Esther, it's just a walking sim. In the purest sense of the word, it's just a walking sim. In Ethan Carter, there are at least very much some puzzles in there mixed in, and they changed it up quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And when you find a dead body, you're able to backtrack a scenario.
I always found the crime scenario thing. That was fun to me.
It was fun to me, too. It felt samey to me towards the end. It was an interesting way to approach a narrative.
Closer to the end, I started noticing, like, the puzzles, like, especially the last two bodies. Like, when you found a dead body, it was, you had to find a couple of items, set up the scene, and then recreate the scenes through like the ghostly images. And it wasn't always clear what was first, what was second, what was third. In the last two bodies, no, it's 1, 2, 3, 4. It was as straightforward as you could get.
Right.
You could just walk from the front to the back. You knew it.
Mm-hmm.
So they started getting a little too easy.
Yeah, especially with the dam was literally 1, 2, 3, 4.
You walked out the door and just chased it 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, it was very clear how it went.
I also want to get some heat off for the first one, the train murder, where I spent 20 minutes looking for a goddamn rock.
Right.
That's bad level design.
That was the other thing I liked about it, actually. It pointed out in the very beginning, this is a game that doesn't hold your hand, which to me said, this is going to be hard, but it turned out not to be that hard. But all the mechanics, you learned by yourself without a written tutorial.
That's... Learning the mechanics is fine to me. However, running around in circles in a large environment, looking for a rock in a forest, with tall grass, with tall trees, I'm gonna get mad about that. Because it's not a unique item. I noticed when I replayed... I know this is weird to continue to compare it to Dear Esther, but at no point in that game did you not know where to walk to. You'd walk into an area and be lost for a minute, but after a short exploration of an area, you would see the exit. Like, my favorite scene is you walk into a cavern, don't see an exit, walk around the cavern and realize there was a second path where you just came in. So there's a difference between hand-holding, to my mind, and giving the player no direction at all. I'll admit, I looked up some of the answers because it's, where's this rock? I don't want to look for a rock in a desert or a forest.
Oh, you looked up the answers?
For that one,
I never had to look up the answers. I'll give you... I'm guessing you're looking for the crank for the trolley, right?
The crank for the trolley was annoying. Just finding certain items was annoying. And a good number of them, if they didn't have text pop up over the top of them when you got close, I would have never noticed them. Because a lot of the scenery was samey, and I couldn't tell you the difference between a lot of those people. Parts and pieces.
How'd you think of the mood of the game? Like, it was almost
bipolar.
It was almost horror. It was almost horror, but it was more of a thriller to me.
More of a thriller, other than the one area where you're walking through the mine shaft and there's a monster in there. My roommate did hear me scream because it caught me once.
Yeah, that was an ingenious moment, actually, come to think of it. Because there's no hostile enemies in that entire game except for that scene. Towards the very end, and it catches you completely off guard.
Well, I got through a good amount of that area without being caught. And then the one moment where I got a little too close to him, he disappeared. I'm like, okay, sweet. I dodged him. And wait, where am I? My controls just left me and he jumped at me. So that was a good jump scare, but overall that scene was okay to me.
We're going to get into the spoiler section now because it's
spoilers.
It's hard to not get into it in this game. What did you think? Let's go ahead and tackle the main point. What did you think about the ending?
It sucked.
Did you really? I didn't like it too much either. I was pretty underwhelmed.
Well, because the ending was, it was all a dream, or it was all a very imaginative boy's imagination. And there wasn't much in the way of foreshadowing for that other than you just knew the boy had an overactive imagination.
I felt like it warned you enough up until that point, because everything up to that moment, like, it foreshadowed, like you said, enough at that point, at least to me, because every other scenario or puzzle you came and finished turned out to be just a real thing that was an overactive imagination. The space guy was a pamphlet about...
A pamphlet and a wooden treehouse that was shaped to be a spaceship.
Right, and then the house was just a moonshine operation, but that, he imagined it was a wizard.
That moonshine house puzzle was actually one of my more favorite ones, because just on the... When you started on the first floor and built the house, and I always got confused because the house wasn't the house. Like, when it broke, the house that you were, the moonshine house, wasn't the same house. But then I went one house over and figured out the real, like, layout you were supposed to be building was a different house.
Right.
And that sent shivers down my spine when I figured it out.
Yeah, that was really cool. I like that puzzle a lot. But, anyway, as I was saying, and all the other puzzles were just his imagination. You had the crack in. And you had the one at the... I think there was another one I'm just forgetting, I feel like. It may not be that...
The Kraken. There was the Mad God. There was the traps at the very beginning.
Yeah, that's right. The traps. And then there was the witch in the forest.
Yes, I don't know if that was a puzzle or just walking into
it. Yeah, that was just walking into it.
There was
that one actually scared me. I like that one. That was like... I thought the actual entity that was taking over the...
Sleeper.
Sleeper. I was going to say Watcher. Yeah. Was, I thought that was that what that was, but it wasn't.
They kept on hinting throughout the story that there was some, like, demigod or something coming to fruition and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
And that was starting to freak me out, but once I kind of figured out the spaceman thing, it kind of broke the illusion, kind of hard
for me. You see, it didn't click until the very end for me. Mm-hmm. And even then, the twist was underwhelming for me.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think, oh, all these weird little side bits, they're a part of his imagination. This main story is clearly a part of his imagination. Because why would it be? I'm the detective that can sense paranormal stuff.
Yeah.
Clearly that's why I'm here. But it turns to be an entire twist, and the entire thing was a lie. It's a dream.
It's a dream.
It was all a dream.
We also missed the one puzzle in the graveyard, which I thought was interesting, but...
Which one was the puzzle in the graveyard?
Essentially, they were trying to bury the kid alive in one of the mosques, and they ended up killing one of the guys who was...
Oh, that was just a typical, like,
No, that was a puzzle. For the most part, it was a puzzle-slash-murder setup.
Okay, I thought it was... I would have called it a murder setup. I wasn't counting it. But yeah, the church, yeah.
The church, which I thought was quite a nice touch, but I found a lot of the story pieces, like his imagination was really... Each piece was kind of disconnected. A couple of them had the connection of the demigod sleeper, but when it came to the end, I'm like, this kid is just kind of imagining all of this. And when it came to the big reveal that your character is imaginary, kind of underwhelmed the whole story, because it's then, well, you weren't actually doing anything. You weren't a person in this. You were a kid's imagination running through his previous stories.
Yeah, I don't want to completely sell it off. I think it was pretty good.
Yeah.
It just... It felt cheap.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the weird thing. I thought it was interesting. And the last words that... it's time to make other stories, basically. I can't remember the exact words.
Yes.
When the kid basically suffocates and it's his imaginary person he made in his head. And the moment up to that... That's the biggest thing. I thought it was completely cheesy of how pissed the mom and the uncle and everyone was, and they like call him a faggot, and the big brother calls him a faggot. That entire dialogue back and forth, I thought was completely corny.
Yeah, it was just a way hateful
too,
family.
Yeah, it was like way too heavy-handed. I mean, it was hateful up with, except for the mom and the dad, but yeah, it just felt entirely too heavy-handed for me. I don't know if you felt the same way or...
Yeah. I never got a good personality check on how the parents actually acted, because they kept on going back and forth in their personalities with the stories.
I feel like that was what we were supposed to infer from the story, though, like with the dad fighting it off and the mom not fighting off as readily. I think the dad was always kind of
weak, but
Ethan.
Yeah.
Ethan, and that's why Ethan's imagination put him able to fight the sleeper.
Yeah, kind of being the redemption hero who fell for it but came back from it.
Mm-hmm. And then his mom not so much, and then his grandpa very much
so was able to fight the sleeper off.
Yeah, both those people, but the uncle and the I can't remember, just the family friend, there were two other people I couldn't remember.
There were two other people,
but they were the ones, the brother and the uncle, I think.
It was,
and the uncle called the son the faggot at the end, and the brother called smeared it in.
Yeah.
Basically at the very end. So I think that was part of the narrative, is you get to infer from his stories what was he thinks of his family and what the family thinks of him.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of neat.
It was,
but
yeah.
It just didn't click. It didn't feel like all the gears were grinding right. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, there wasn't... The stories were too short, like even with the last damn murder scene. Like, there's not... We kept on getting small story nuggets that were just really, really short. And they didn't emphasize the characters enough. You'd have to build the murder scene, and it'd take 10-15 minutes to build the murder scene. Then the clip of what happened plays, but the clip was only 15 to 30 seconds. You can't... And saying there were 10 out of that, but if you take out... Not everybody was in every scene. Take out the space astronaut, there's only 9 scenes. That's 3 minutes. You can't build a good character diagnostic off of that, so it's hard to tell, and each time the characters were acting differently, not always consistently, so how these characters acted was still kind of vague.
So, did you get to the very end and miss any of the puzzles?
I got to the very end, and I had never found the spaceman puzzle, because it was deep lost in the woods, so I had to go back and pick that one up.
Okay. Yeah, I got to the very end, and I was so confused. I had to make sure there wasn't a secret ending, because I didn't find all the things. Because that's the one thing I think it did really well. It made a giant, massive map, but still made it feel linear and made me not able to miss everything. It did a good job of that.
So it didn't let you finish the story incomplete. You had to go back and get every little nugget.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't feel like they were hiding a narrative piece out in the middle of buttfuck nowhere.
Yeah.
I think they did that. Did a really good job of that. So the argument I always hear, bringing it back to Dear Esther, is Dear Esther does a good job of looking pretty, but the argument for it is it's not very much a game. Mm-hmm. It's not, its narrative is thick, and to a lot of people it's, what's the word, pretentious.
Pretentious, that's an understatement.
And there's no, did I ever say there's no game?
There is no game.
It's walk.
It's a walking simulator.
There's no running, and running would help great. Mm-hmm. And then people that say that then say the Vanishing of Ethan Carter, they often cite it as a better version of Dear Esther. And I can see where they're getting that, because it has all the things
they're starting into that, but okay, I'll be fair. I will never recommend Dear Esther to anybody unless they're really into the art, because that game is artistic. It's pretentious. I'm glad it happened. I'm glad Dear Esther is something to look at, and we can say, here is, like, in our culture, the really artsy, pretentious pieces of work. They need to be there. Does everybody have to play them? No. But it's nice to have something at the far end of the spectrum to look at that is more of just art, narrative, story, not so much game. I like having something at the far end. Now, The Vanishing of Ethan Carter doesn't really bring itself far enough back in for me to consider it a game, because a lot of it was still a walking simulator, but you had the run button. It's still a walking simulator to my definition, and it came back on the narrative pretty badly. As hard as it was to understand Dear Esther, just playing through it and listening to the poetry they pretty much write as their dialogue is more than enough for me. I may not know what's going on, but I'm interested in to see how you say it. Mm-hmm. Very much so, but so there's a lot of qualms going back and forth with it. I think I would probably still recommend Dear Esther before I recommend The Vanishing of Ethan Carter some people.
I completely agree. The only time I think I would recommend The Vanishing of Ethan Carter is someone that just got done playing Dear Esther and complained about the things.
And complained about that, yeah.
Because compared to a lot of other video games, The Vanishing of Ethan Carter is still really good looking. Yeah,
it's by all means, it's better looking than Dear Esther, to a degree.
A bunch of walking sims, it's probably one of the better ones, too.
It's more interactive, yeah.
I feel like we're selling it kind of short, but but yeah, final thoughts?
Recommended for somebody who's not that big into walking simulators, but would like to see more of a narrative experience in their game.
I agree for the most part. I would recommend it for anyone looking for a good walking simulator in general.
Fair enough.
Alright.
Thank you all so much for watching. If you're interested in other walking simulators, you can click to the right here for my review on Eidolon. It's a more interesting art style kind of walking sim survival game. And if you're looking for something a little bit more lowbrow, you can click to the left here for my review of Jazz Punk. Alright, thanks again, and take it easy, guys. Bye.